and it's Uncovered. Today we get to talk to the acting IGP, Mr. John Kudalor, and he served in several capacities until 2012. He was the Assistant Commissioner of Police and then became Deputy Commissioner of Police from 2012 to date. And then in 2015, he was appointed as the Acting Inspector General of Police. As a man who's worked with BNI, he's worked in investigations and has experiences in weapons, movement of people and the like, you know, what does he bring to bear, especially, you know, as he supervises 2016 elections? Remember, he was part of the strategic team that led the successful, free, transparent and fair elections in 2012. Today, he will be the one in charge. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you, madam.
Today, sir. Happy New Year to you and the best of 2016 to you as well, sir. First of all, was it a surprise for you?
Oh, like any policeman, any soldier, I would like to become a general. We're working and hoping to reach the top in our career. So it was a pleasant surprise, I would say. That's how I put it, a pleasant surprise.
Okay. I know that you have a very good relationship with the Inspector General of Police, ex-Inspector General of Police, Mr. Paul Terry-Okwe and Mr. Muhammad Alas. In fact, they're actually your referees as well. Yeah. How is your relationship with them like now? And do you seek counsel from them?
Oh, the relationship is still cordial. And whenever it's necessary to seek counsel, I contact them, even go beyond, because we have an array of Inspector General of Police on retirement who are ready to serve. Most of them have come to office to share ideas with me and my vision, my programs, and I always share it with them to make sure that I'm on track, and also the ideas that I want to bring on board are also, you know, consistent with policing regulations and our general vision.
Okay. When you say your vision, I know one of the first things you did was to hold the commanders conference where you brought all your regional commanders here at the headquarters, and you are laid, you know, your vision and talked about setting up, you know, political desk because the election is that important to you. What else was the reason behind that commanders conference?
Oh, it was quite necessary, and then I'd say that one was unique because for some time now we've not been able to bring the commanders down, and also I felt that they should hear it firsthand, and you know, passing it through the usual channel of signals and administrative instructions. I wanted to see them face to face, discuss with them, brainstorm, and to see whether they understand my vision and also my mission, and also to ensure that they also give in their contributions, because they are in the field, and each field terrain is different from the other, so that they'll bring on board whatever problems and challenges they have, whatever suggestions they have to move the service forward. And together we'll get a general pool, a general policy, so that all of us will agree on and follow. So that if you are backtracking or you're not on course and action is taken, you cannot blame anybody.
Okay. And following that, you did a reshuffle of the police administration. And I know that you moved for instance, you had the Director General of Public Affairs, but now it's just at the Director of Public Affairs. Why?
You know, police, we have levels. At this level, it cannot be a Director General. It's not alone. The man in charge, who's even senior to him in rank, is also for the National Patrol Department, is also a director. You can only become a director general when you have the rank of a deputy commissioner or above. That's why. But the duties and responsibilities do not change a little, because the office is the office that is important. It's not the personality there. So you can even be an assistant superintendent, but the office of PAD is still there with its functions, and that's what we have to do. So I think. There's something in name though, but as far as we are concerned, it's the office and functions that are supreme.
Oh no, I was asking about why, you know, you moved the Director General off and then decided to maintain just at the director level. Does that in any way impede? Some have suggested that if you have Director General or you have Director, the Director cannot be part of your meetings because that person has to take minutes. If you can clear that
for
us.
No, I don't think that is an issue. They are just stretching and belaboring the point. Because if you are a headquarters senior officer, there's no specific rank that, to me, cast in stone that it must be of some rank before can be a scheduled officer. It's the offices that count. So you can be of any rank. I don't want to give examples, but I personalize them, but there have been a lot of instances before, some decades back, where people of lower ranks, the lower ranks of the senior police officer's rank have been scheduled officers and have been in charge of various schedules. It's the schedule that matter. If the schedule is a headquarters schedule, you have to, because you do everything in the name of the Inspector General of Police. So your rank does not matter per se, but it's the office. And the function, as I said, that remains unimpeded.
Okay. All right.
Unimpeded, yeah.
Okay. You launched the Election Security Task Force, and the police, Ghana Police Service, is the lead agency that is driving the work of the Election Security Task Force. Currently, what are they doing?
Well, currently, you know, the task force has been launched and they have hit the ground running. Some of the regions could not have theirs on the same day because of the demonstration by the TUC. But as I talk to you now, all the regions have in place their task forces and they have started working. There are various committees. The committees have started working. They meet once every week for now. Very soon they'll be meeting almost daily. They'll bring in their inputs to a preliminary session. Now they are now working committee levels, and every month they'll meet to discuss what each committee has decided on to the general pool. They'll discuss, and then finally we'll start meeting as a group. And incidentally, the Special General Police, the chairman, the national chairman, so it will come to my desk, I'll discuss with them, and then we'll see how to chart a very successful and transparent, incident-free elections.
Okay. What about it is the most important to you? I mean, I know you have, what's it called, the ballot box security, other subcommittees.
Yes.
So which one is the most important to you?
Well, to me, it is important because it should work side by side. If you remove one, the center will not hold. For example, if you remove the ballot unit from it, or the ballot committee, that's very critical because that's where the winner will come from. And I understand they maybe have it declared this time. The police stations will declare the winner. There's some small change, I think. So the ballot paper, this will be very critical. Again, the mobilization, where personnel will be mobilized to police the elections too, cannot be said to be this insignificant, because if they're not there, you know the chaos that can happen at the police stations. Funding is also there. Investigation. So each, and this is very critical, because the investigation will have to come out with the true events that occurred in any setting. So to me, all the committees are very, very important. Thus, they are being created and established. They all have to work hand in hand and be treated equally.
Okay. Quite recently, I mean, you're an operational man and you've served in different capacities. Your last was the Director General of Operations at the police headquarters, and one of the things you had to deal with was the demonstration, Let My Vote. Can I remember the president said that you should probe into it? Where are we with investigations? Have we concluded?
Oh yeah, it has been concluded.
What's the outcome?
The outcome will be have to be decided by the powers that access to investigate. I was supposed to investigate, bring us our findings and recommendations to the appropriate authority. And that's what I'll say for now. We've done that. So at the appropriate time, they will let the public know if it is so necessary. But we'll finish with our part of the directives.
Okay. You recently granted an interview, and to quote you, you said that you abhor, you know, corruption. You abhor men who decide to disgrace the uniform that you wear. And personally, I want to know from you, it's one of the things you have to battle. Last night, I was reading the Transparency International report, and they gave us some very positive reviews about, you know, Ghana's fight against corruption and bribery. What would you be doing to make it so unattractive that men who wear the uniform will feel that pride and joy that you wear as you lead them?
Yes, I think this is just will be sanctioned. What summarize it in one word? That is sanctions, sanctions, and sanctions. You don't have to condone it in any way and in any form. No, I don't know whether you are aware, but it's surprised to know that since half of my career in the police service has been with the performance unit.
Professional standard.
I started it when it was the Special Police Command, or even the Complaints Unit. I was a member of that team, Special Police Command, the Monitor Inspection Unit, and then the PIPS. I was the person who even established the first commander. So I've been through it all, and I even had a chance of going abroad to be trained at the Federal Investigations School in a FBI training school in Quantico. Also, which was one of my core papers, that is internal affairs. So I have this behavior or discipline aspect of police very close to my heart. And as I said, it will be sanctions, sanctions, sanctions. We are not going to bend the rules in any way if you are found to be corrupt and have extorted or behaved unprofessionally.
Mm-hmm. One of them would be PIPs, having to investigate, you know, cases that are sent to them quickly, on time, and then it gets to the IGP office, and that will be. So how would you facilitate that process?
Oh, that's why PIPs has been reinforced and then be enhanced. We sent a deputy commissioner of police there, a very experienced man, and Pabin is there. The numbers have been increased, logistics and everything have been increased. We make sure that we check their roster every day, make sure they don't become armchair, you know, internal affairs officers. You must not wait for a case to be brought to them. You must be very proactive, going around and seeing that people are on duty lawfully and legally, behaving very civil and professionally. So that's what we are doing to enhance and empower them. And their reports are also taken very, very seriously to motivate them that what they are doing is not in vain.
Okay. I'm just going to move away from this. We'll come back to that. But being an IGP, I mean, I have been here. We've been in queue for close to like an hour and the like. Yeah. Do you get a moment for yourself where you get to sit and reflect, you know, a time for yourself? Do you get that moment?
Yes.
Do you get that opportunity?
It's time management. Unfortunately for you, today is the day that's the IGP's day. Today is Thursday, and this is the day I received my visitors.
Okay.
We've not seen anything at all today. But you have to manage your time. I come very early on this Saturday, that's Thursday, come around 6:37, work, receive visitors from 10 to 2, and then work again. Make sure that my file and table is cleared before. So as soon as I leave here, at 7:38, depending upon the exigencies of the day.
Okay. But if you are not in the office, what are you doing?
Well, I'm either reading.
Oh, okay.
Yes,
reading. Oh, you love reading.
Yeah.
What do you read?
I read the initiatives and then. So, and a lot of African writers, you know. Yeah.
Okay. How different is being an IGP, you know, from being a commissioner of police, director general of operations? How different is that? Because operations, you know, you're on the forefront, demonstrations, we see you. I have seen you at every major demonstration that this country has experienced. How different is it to being an IGP?
Oh, I would say it's the scope of work.
Okay.
The scope of work. But how they call it, the rules and regulations and the framework is the same, but the scope, you know, as a director of operations, you know, it's operations and pure operations, but in the IGP seat, combined operations and all other schedules as an administrator and manager. So it makes the scope more larger, and also we have more other meetings and others to attend outside the office. So it's more challenging and tasking, as I say, as an IGP, because being in charge of over 30,000 personnel, you can know what it looks like.
I see. But you miss being an operational man? Because you mentioned it, yes, the scope.
Yes.
Because more administrative. And, you know, at the very height, you probably go to the president when there's a big function. Do you miss being...
Yes, a police work is operations. As we say, operations is the heartbeat of policing. And once an operational man, I always love to be on the forefront. If you remember the Ashaman routes, I don't know whether you were in media.
I remember you were
there. I was at the forefront and being held with stones left and right. That's what I love, because policeman, that's a policeman job. Contemporary duties is the core function of policing. Mm-hmm. So I miss the operations, and I'm always standing hand with them, working, and I'm supervised and ensure that my soul is there. I've left, but my soul is still with them.
Your soul is still with them.
Yeah.
That's a big one.
Yeah.
Okay. And for people who want to join the police service, being the presenter of you in the police, some people believe that you can actually get them into the police service. And I've consistently told them that I have no links whatsoever. And sometimes when you ask them, the reasons are, because they just want a job. Do you think people are just coming into the police service, you know, not necessarily having gone out hard, but just because they want a place to hide? And so that defeats the purpose of joining the police.
Yes, as you said, it defeats the purpose. And I think then they are going to the wrong place. Because policing is not a job. Neither is it a profession. Police is an occupation and a calling. This is what must drive you to become a policeman. Mm-hmm. But and as I've told my boys, none of us was conscripted into to become a policeman. It must be the love and passion of policing. It's not like going to wear the cassock. So if they just want it just because they want an employment, which police of course is not basically, then I bet you mean they are finding themselves in the wrong place, and no sooner than later they will find a place too hot and may have to leave.
How does that hurt the police? How does that hurt the police?
It hurts the police in many ways, because you know what they go through to become a policeman. You have to go undergo training courses and all many other things, and they get the skill and everything. You know, our training period too, it's a matter of just taking someone from the street and getting him into employment. There's a process. Just about 6 months, minimum 9 months to become a policeman. So immediately leave, the vacuum created, it's immediately, you know, occupied. And it hurts us, because policing is numbers. If we talk about policing, it is numbers and numbers and numbers. We need more boots on the ground. So when they leave, of course, the level falls, and our bid to get to the UN ratio of 1 to 500 is defeated in one way or the other.
Okay. I know. Is that why, you know, sometimes you have people who are unable to stand the physical training, physical aspect of the training that comes with the service, you know, the recruitment process? Could that be a factor?
Yes, it's a factor. And if they live at the training level, it's better for us than coming in all the way 1, 2, 3 years and retire. It's a training factor because they think it's just easy. But it's training. So before you join the police, as well, it's a regimented institution and it's a very rigid regime of training. All this must take into consideration before deciding to become a policeman. Now I'm saying that it's a calling and not a job or employment, per se.
Okay. Recently, the Ghana Armed Forces, you know, did a mass dismissal, if I should put it that way, of men who want to join the force but unfortunately could not stand the training. They call it more treatment. What signal did that send to the police service? You know, is your training anywhere close to what the Ghana Armed Forces go through? And are you looking at, you know, modernizing or reviewing it to be more
human? Yeah, I'm not privy to what exactly happened informed the Armed Forces decision. But on my part as a police chief, I will not tolerate indiscipline. And also, our training is regimented. It's a regimented institution. And we work strictly according to the rules that God has, in both its spirit and in a letter. Anything short of that will bring foul to our service instructions. So it's a signal that it's a human institution that we must be very careful and circumspect and very astute, because along the line we can have some, I would say, bad apples. Mm. I don't say rotten, but bad apples coming in to contaminate the good ones.
Okay, all right. Then I want to go back to still on the recruitment. I mean, I think in 2014, late, then 15, you know, the police was rocked with a very huge scandal that your predecessor tried to work around it, and we heard of a report. So where are we with Mr. Tembila's issue?
Oh, the report is ongoing. As I always say, the team has been asked to go through all the necessary processes as soon as possible. But you know, this is, as you said, a big issue that has been tried. I don't know how to end, but we have to go through all the procedures, because I think the witnesses are quite many, and then it was also been made to give his side of the story. And so we are still, it's all ongoing. So the impression has not been given that it has been swept under the carpet, but we are still in an appropriate time. Sooner than later, we shall make bear our findings to the general public.
Okay, so Mr. Tembila is still under arrest?
Oh, he has not been under arrest, so far as I know. Okay. I'll say he's on interdiction.
Okay, he's on interdiction. And then the investigation is still ongoing.
Yes.
How soon should we expect? Because people would use that as a benchmark and also say that indeed the police say they are fighting not just recruitment scam or whatever, but rooting corruption at the very core of it.
You know, I don't know what the final findings will be.
Okay.
So I would not like to go there. But what I would say is that we are not ready to compromise any discipline. We are all equal before the law. Most we are Ghanaians, and that's exactly what we are doing. I would say that the report will be ready sooner than later.
But why do you think this whole people who call themselves, you know, agents? The police has not hired anybody to be an agent to recruit,
yes.
And people are willing to pay through those people with the help of people who are already in the service. And why do you think that is? And what is your own opinion of, you know, people who act as agents to help recruitment?
Oh,
in recruitment.
I will go over what you said. Do you see our public in its nature is susceptible to this? How they call it, nuances, and this give chance for people to exploit.
Mm.
Because it's not only even police recruitment, even this scam, this ghost scam and other things. And so on thief time, we've gone up on the air to go and talk and advise the public that don't do this. Because the Precious Mineral Commission pays higher this rates for gold. So if you see the gold that journey, do you think a person will come and sell it to you at a low price if you can go to the Precious Minerals and get a good price? But people still come, but to the back door, go and they are cheated or this is how they call it, short change. The same in every human endeavor. You know, policing, recruitment, everybody wants to be a policeman. I don't know, maybe the appeal of the uniform or
the name, they are paid or well.
The authority.
They
I don't
are, paid,
know.
Are they paid the well?
So I don't know, but I think it's a human nature. And we are trying to work towards it to eradicate it as much as possible by removing the human factor, by trying to go, as I've said, some few instances I've had a chance, I want to go e-recruitment.
Mm.
To at least not, if it doesn't, eradicate that, or it may reduce the instances of corruption agents, you know, swindling people and other things.
Okay, all right. One of the things that I have, heard officers talk about is issue of transfers, that sometimes, you know, when they work with officers and they are not liked, they are transferred, or when, you know, there's a new IGP comes in and IGP has to work with his own people and moves people around. When does the police consider it necessary to transfer individuals?
Oh, transfer is one of police actions. It's not meant to be punishment. Of course, we look at our, how they call it, our scope of punishment. I don't know, I don't remember the transfer as part of punishment. Mm. But the, in the human mentality, in the psyche of people, they tend some places to be good places, some places to be bad places. I don't understand. But there's some places that they tend to be good where I would never like to work, if you have been paid extra to go to those places. So it's a human mentality and the psychic of the individual. But after transfers, this administrator comes, he has to get a team he can physically deliver with. It's not done everywhere, not only in policing circles. And I think people should not look at it as a punishment. But if you look at a punishment, be meaningful to yourself. But to me, it's just a police, it's a tool in policing. Because the more you stay in the station, you become familiar and may not be able to perform. That may be the reason, main reason why. So we, administratively, we have 4 years, 5 years in a place. We have to move on for another person to come because you become so familiar with the terrain, come with the people that find very difficult to perform. That's why people come to you and then ask you to lock people arbitrarily, and you do so such behaviors. So transfer should not be standard this thing at all. It's just,
but have you had complaints of people who say, okay, maybe I'm doing my job well, but my commander, my immediate commander, doesn't like me? And so have you had that complaint? Even when you were operation, not even as IG, but when you were
through my police career, it has happened. That one is a human relationship, and I think it's not in policing. And that so far as human beings are together, there will be this small, I'll say problems. But I'll take them to problems which are natural and will come. And once you're not, if you're working well, maybe because of your good work, maybe asked to go to a place that is collapsing to bring it up. That can also be a reason for being transferred. But people look at it in a very skewed way that I think it should not be the case. In a more broader perspective, yes.
But you're a father of four,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
How old three. Is it? Yeah. Oh, three? Yeah. Oh, okay, all right. How old is the first one?
About 30 years.
Okay. When do you have time for them?
Oh, they are all big boys and a big boy and big girls now. And they're all well placed. So they come to visit me rather once in a while, weekends. Other than that, we seldom see each other. We speak over the phone and enjoy this thing because I'm proud of them. And yeah, they are doing very well.
Okay. I want to. This is something that you say you live by, that you're a very determined person and you always work to attain the highest level of efficiency in whatever capacity you find yourself in the Ghana Police Service.
Yeah.
As the IGP, what is the one thing that you want to be able to achieve, that you want to be remembered with when you leave office?
Oh, I want to be remembered, that has been my vision always too, that I came to establish a very professional, astute, very civil police, and then the most important, a police service that had gained a lot of public trust during my tenure of office.
Mm. What do you think is the current public, you know, relations with the police? What's the trust level? What do you think?
Oh, I think the trust level, you know, you better know it than I am. The perception is so, you know, muddied with a lot of things which I think are not right or are not the true this in a reflection of policing. So my, as I said, to eradicate that perception out of the public mind, you know, people take, you know, these few days we find a lot of mob action and other things because the reason they don't trust the police will carry the case to its logical conclusion. These are things I want to have to be things of the past when I'm leaving the service. I say, yes, this is a police service. We can go and sleep with our two eyes closed. We can come out, give complaints, and we'll be followed. We'll be received in a very civil manner. The police have to know that the people have employed them, and they are there to serve. That's what I want to do.
But what do you think caused that perception?
Oh, the perception, I think, has been there long before when I joined the service. And I want to say that it's not something that happens only policing, but because we are constant, you know, contact with the public, everything that you do easily comes to public glare and public view. Mm. That's why that perception is sticking on. And of course, we have badness among us because it's a human institution. Especially when you are doing a recruitment, to face for a particular purpose. You know, many people are coming, the vetting, you know, possible vetting takes a long time, so we get some bad news coming inside. But I think generally, I would say that about 99.9999% of policemen are good men. And they've come to serve their nation.
Okay, and before we go, I know the elections mean so much to you because you are sitting atop of all the security details that would come out eventually, and you pride yourself as being one of the strategic men that led the success of the 2012 elections. And so, as a result, you have set up the regions set up political desks which will monitor, you know, political activities and the like. Are they really active in the regions currently?
Oh yes, in fact, policing, there are way of reporting. We have captions under which we report. We report on land matters, chieftaincy, political and other things. So the political issues have been there, but because it's an election, I want it to stand out, to be given the prominence and then attention that it needs. So it's a new creature, but not totally new, but we are giving it more, we are enforcing it, enhancing it, and to make it more effective. And it's now in all the regional capitals where they have the task force, we have that DEX. And as you know, it's going to permeate down to the district levels, which is going to be replicated. So, believe me that when you go around, you can ask for the DEX officers and you see them very professional officers of good standing who give very objective and appropriate reports, not colored with any, eye or. College, but to be seen in this right perspective.
Okay, which area, I mean, in terms of geographic, is the police more concerned about as the build up to the 2016 elections?
Oh, to us as policemen, all the geographical areas are quite important. You know, we have some places with flashpoints, maybe the flashpoints may be more than others, but to us, flashpoints are not static creatures, they are dynamic. So every police station is a flashpoint, because if you lose guard, we're talking about events. So we work to what we call the worst scenarios. So to us, all the regions can have worst scenarios, and that's what we are working towards, so that when it happens, we can be able to react. And of course, some regions are more populous than others, and we shall skew our strength towards those things. But on a scale, I'll say they are all on the same scale, so far as elections are concerned, every police will be as active as they are, the smallest. If you work it proportionally, the activity there will also be the same as the biggest. If you need to work in proportion, you see that. If 100 people are here, you give them 100%, you see the proportion of activity, and then it's what they call it, problems that might occur. This way, it's only 5%. The level of this thing will be the other I'm talking from the mathematical point of view, and of course, on a scientific basis, of course.
Okay. What do you say to people who are of the view that the police are more involved, they do better investigations, they get to conclusions of investigations that gain public prominence and interest? And other than that, other cases are not well investigated and are swept under.
Oh, I don't think that is correct, because in investigation, a lot of things come into play. Most of the cases that the individuals are talking about, when they report, they don't come again. We have a lot of cases which have been reported, they don't come again. But the high profile one, we have the investigators coming. And then there's a public pressure in the papers, it's been spoken about, so everybody's involved. So you have to get to this logical conclusion. But the low ones, as we talk, the individual ones, people don't even come after reporting. That's why they don't come. That's why that disparity. But towards every case, it's very, very serious, as much as it's called. And every caller is an ally. So we treat everybody equally, and then all cases equally.
IGP John Kudalor, thank you very much for talking to us on New Day. Well, that's Uncovered with the Acting Inspector General of Police, Mr. John Kudalor. There's a lot more coming up.